They may try to steal our instruments. They may try to steal our beats. And he may try to mimic our voice. He may try to silence our voice. He may try to decree an order to ban our voices. I'm not gonna name his name, but you guys know who I'm talking about. But I'm excited because history repeats itself. Because even if he tries to steal our voices, even if he sets an army again and again, he will never be able to steal our voice. Sauti Yetu is a reflection of our voice. It's a reflection of our history. It's a celebration of beauty and love. Every clef, every note, it echoes our voice, and our voice is unique. And despite having our instruments stolen from us, from our ancestors, forced to go from the land of the unknown, our voice has never sounded better. Our musical rhythm has never been louder. From a cappella to the island chants of the Caribbean and through the chorus of our ancestors in the cotton fields, our voices echoes today. Our voice are composed of different notes. It rings a harmony reflected from the different cultures that form our chords. So tonight, I'd like to invite you to celebrate the different voices in the room and in this world with me. This month, not even this month, this whole year, I'd like to remind you to have the hope that despite the cacophony that is going on in the world, in this America, your voice still matters. Your voice counts, and your voice is great. So today, we're here to celebrate our voice. And right now, I'd like to recognize my wonderful members of BALSA. Please stand up if you're not, if you're seated. BALSA members, you are. And I would like to recognize Lucky and Brittany, who have done excellent. Dedication to the group and the preparation that you have done to prepare this event. Before I start, I just want to say a word of prayer. If you're not okay with that, that's okay, but I would like to say it, to use my voice to say a word of prayer. Thank you, Father God, for this wonderful day. Thank you so much for reminding us that we can use our voice to worship you, and no matter who we pray to, no matter who, our beliefs are. Thank you for this freedom that we have. Thank you so much for the freedom that you gave our ancestors to believe that you exist and that freedom they held up to. Thank you. In your name I pray. Amen. All right, let's use our voices to welcome Lucky.
For those of you who don't know me, my name is Lucky Malad, and I'm a 1L here. And we have, for those of you who don't know me, so what we have prepared, what my job is I'm going to tell you about the food first. I'm going to like walk you through this whole experience. So a lot of people have put a lot of sweat, not in the food, but like, no, but you know, a lot of people that didn't know how to follow a good direction. Follow good direction, and they made you guys a bunch of good West African food. So I know a lot of you aren't familiar with West African food, so I'm gonna walk y'all through this so that y'all ain't lost, okay? So what you're gonna do is you're gonna Chipotle this thing. You're gonna pick a base. So your base is either gonna be rice or what we call fufu, which is kind of like a dough-like consistency. It's individually wrapped in saran wrap. And then you're gonna pick a stew. There's a palm nut stew, which is made from the palm nut, which is, it's in West Africa. I'm not a botanist, I can't tell you about it. It's edible, it's really good. There's a palm nut stew with beef, there's an okra stew with beef, and I know everybody doesn't eat meat, so I made a vegan okra stew for people who don't eat meat. And at the end, we have fried plantains. For the love of God, please don't eat fufu by itself. Put a stew on it. please don't eat it by itself. Put a stew on it. And we're not gonna go in cafe fashion, so what I want you guys to do is when you line up, go like behind the table and swing around to get the food, okay? And there, it's labeled, pick a base, pick a stew. Please don't like kill my African heart and eat fufu by itself. Y'all got that? All right, if y'all got it, then first let me allow speakers, Michael, Mary Ellen, y'all go eat and then everybody can just like get in line, go try it. Know what you're watching. So over break, I was sitting with my mom and I noticed we were watching a documentary, and I noticed that all the documentaries that I would watch were from the perspectives of either people who were born, raised directly from Africa, or they were from people who were African American or so far removed down the diaspora. And I never got answers to the questions that you're gonna see in this video from people like me. So for those of you who don't know, first generation American. My mother is from Cote d'Ivoire, my father is from Egypt. And I never got things from my perspective. I never got these questions answered from my perspective. And I was curious to see how some of my peers would answer these questions. And I asked the interviewees, is that the correct term? The interviewees some open-ended questions, and a lot of themes kept coming up, such as colorism, identity, consciousness, things like that. So this is what we put together with the help of Michael, who is our videographer, and Mary Ellen. And I really, really, really hope you guys enjoy it. And if something sticks out to you, keep it in the back of your head, because after this, we have our panelists who are up here, and we're going to talk about it, OK? All right, we're starting. I'm glad you guys liked it. At this time, I'd like to invite our two speakers to come and take a seat at the table. Yeah, let's go through. Yeah, that's it. Let the masses filter out. So I'm going to give our panelists a chance to introduce themselves, give a short spiel on who they are, what they do. A lot of you should know Professor Bob. And then I'm going to ask some questions, and then we'll open it up to the floor. So, yeah.
Okay, home field advantage. So I'm Tracy Bach. I'm a professor here. I've been teaching here for about 21 years. In fact, I remember it because my oldest son, who's about to turn 26, went off to kindergarten the day I went off to teach my first class here. So I am Caucasian, right? I'm probably a product of a lot of mixing, German, British, Italian, French. I grew up outside of Philadelphia. But I think one of the reasons that I was invited here is because I've chosen in my adult life in the last 15 or so years to live once in East Africa, in Rwanda, which becomes Eastern more. When I was there, it was a little more aligned with the Congo. Now it tends to be, well, not tends, it's part of the Congo, so it looks a little more eastward toward Kenya. And then about 7 years ago, I lived in West Africa, in Senegal. Where I was a Fulbright scholar. So the one or two stories that I wanted to share with you, I think goes back to that, that kid or those kids. Jordan, I don't know where you are now. First of all, I just want to say, I should start with, that video was stunning.
Yeah.
It really, really was. Not just stunning because it shows the amazing range of students at BLS, but it was stunning for the honesty. Speaking to a camera like that, and speaking from your heart, knowing it's going to be watched by a lot of people who are here focusing on their minds to think like lawyers, that's not an easy thing. And so a couple of things jumped out at me that that I wanted to relay in terms of just purely anecdotal, really, not analytical, not professorly, a reply. One, I was going to get back to Jordan. Jordan was talking about somebody touching his hair. I'll always remember when we lived in Rwanda, my youngest son was six, he turned seven when we were there. And my husband is a blonde-haired, or was, he's now gray and mostly bald. But it's, I'll tell him. He still thinks he's blonde-haired. So the youngest looks like it. And so Matthew learned a few words of Kinyarwanda. Amakuru, Meza, which means hi, how are you, right? Just like the beginning of the video. But he learned to say Retiraho, which means don't touch me. Because he was an adorable little miniature Mzungu, we were called there, and he had bright blonde hair. And so I think forever, in fact, he said it to the dean of my law faculty when I introduced him, because he came up to, you know, touch his hand, and he just instinctively, it was toward the end of the academia, said, Retirajo. I was like, no, Matthew, chill, he's not going to touch your hair. So, fundamentally, and I can, of course, tell you stories of the oldest, who was on a soccer pitch and came home one day and said, you know, I don't get the ball, they're discriminating against me. Really, why? You know, is it because you don't speak Swahili? No. Is it because you're smaller than the other guy? No. Is it because your Kinyarwanda is non-existent? No. Not as fast? Not as good? No. It's because I'm white. I'm the only white person. That year was an amazing journey for our family because, not surprisingly, kids had grown up here in a predominantly white culture. And had never ever been a minority, had never been a in a place where their very being provoked people to look at them constantly, to question their place in that part of the world, to touch them, to violate too strong, but to constantly question their presence and their right to be there. And we had Mzungu privilege, which was white. So, I'm going to stop there and turn it over, but I really want to thank Balsa for doing this, not only getting us all together and feeding us really good West African food, which I miss, and someday, maybe the next year, I can make chibujen to add.
Can you make chibujen?
No.
I can give you a run for your money.
This is better. I was the worker bee that year. My husband was home taking care of the kitchen. So he makes a mean chicken and a very good yasapule.
Uh-huh. Okay.
All right, but I'd love to contribute next year to the culinary treats, but I do want to just recognize how amazing this gathering is tonight, because we spend so much time thinking about things, and I think what's cool here is we're thinking and feeling at the same time. And actually, I forgot to say one really important thing. Joe, you should have stopped me. The faculty sends its regards.
Okay.
And the reason we do that is because we're all over at 107 deliberating about the next dean of our law school. So that meeting started at 3:45, and I got to get my two cents in by saying, I'm going to the Balsa event tonight. And they all went, oh. So they send their regards.
Thank you.
Yeah. A meeting that started at
3:45. Yeah.
Oh my, I would be so asleep. My name is Dottie Morris, and I live in Vermont, but I work in New Hampshire at a state college called Keene State College. I'm associate professor of psychology, and also my main job is chief diversity officer for the college. I was blown away by the video. It was amazing in so many ways, and I think that the idea that it took so much courage to get up there and say some of those things. I find that it's easier for me to talk like that in front of strangers than it is to talk in front of people I have to see every day. So I think that getting there, and answering those questions for your peers, wow, that's really amazing. I want a copy of that. I think that I've been doing a lot of thinking lately. I grew up in Louisiana. I've lived in New England probably around, but it's been double digits. But I grew up in Louisiana, and I have to say I'm a proud descendant of slaves. And so oftentimes people don't usually think of proud descendant of slaves as a phrase. But I've come to embrace that part of my identity with a lot of pride. Because I feel like not to be proud of their survival would be a disservice to their survival. And I refuse to allow the bullies, the colonizers, the slave traders to reframe the narrative and make me feel ashamed of people who survived so I could be here today. And I refuse to dishonor their survival by being ashamed of being a descendant of slaves. So I'll just tell you one thing. I didn't come to that on my own, okay? Let me tell you how I came to it. A few years ago, and as you can tell, I'm far removed from being a teenager, but a few years ago, my little niece had to do a report on Frederick Douglass. And she was in first grade, and I didn't know that they made first graders do PowerPoints. She's six, let her do some crayons. But she had to do a report on Frederick Douglass. So I found out that my dear sister here used to live in Houston. I'm sorry. So she lives in Houston, and so my sister took her to, you know, all of these museums, and they did all this research on Frederick Douglass, and she was about ready to do her little PowerPoint, I guess, age-appropriate, six, PowerPoint. And so she looked at my sister, and she said, "I don't know where to start." And so my sister said, "Well, we've done all of this research, we've gone to all of these museums, we have pictures, you know, what do you mean you don't know where to start?" And she said, "If I have to write that he was a slave, that means I'm a slave." And she started to cry. So at six, she already had this kind of notion that that was the only story of who she was. And I always realized that there was a story, a pre-slave story of my ancestors, because there was a pre-slave story. And in American history in the United States, we always start with the slave narrative of people who look like me. And so I decided, when my sister called me saying, "What should I do?" Because that's the bad thing about being a psychologist. Stuff happens. I'm like, "I don't know, I don't have any children." But one thing that came of that was I started to realize that the number of people who carry that shame to the point of crying because they have to write something about such an amazing person in history, Frederick Douglass with two S's. I thought that was really cool. But this whole idea that that was happening, and part of hearing about her crying, I could reconnect with that little girl in me who had carried that shame. And so for her, just her survival, I had to embrace this whole idea of a proud descendant of slaves. And so we have a lot of conversations about what Elizabeth Chimamanda Adichie said. It depends on where you start the story. So if you start with secondly, it's a different story than when you start the story at the beginning. And so we've had a lot of talks about the beginning pre-slavery, because there was a narrative before then. So that's a long introduction, but I like to at least let people know why I say that I'm a proud descendant of slaves.
Okay, so. Well, they're awesome people. So the first thing I want you guys to do before we open the discussion out is I want you guys to give us a definition of imperialism. Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to give you a vocabulary lesson. Would you like to go first, Professor Frog?
Maybe I didn't. Did you put that
thing
in the
email? Yeah.
I didn't do my homework.
Okay, so
we'll do it together.
We're going to collab.
Oh, there you go.
Because I did look it up.
Oh, okay.
I saw just one
page. A textualist approach?
Yeah. So, I mean, there's the classic definition of where a country, usually defined as a country, but it doesn't have to be, is extending its boundaries, its power, by taking over another country by force, or sometimes not force, by diplomacy, economic imperialism we think of today. And so for me, with the time that I've spent in Africa, I think of the scramble for Africa, they call it, the Berlin Conference of the late 1880s, and that period of time from the 1880s to, right around World War I, probably around 1914 or so, yeah, would be, or probably up to 1917, when Europe took over something like 20% of the world in terms of geography, in terms of that imperialism. Mostly les Français, or I should say, not mostly, the UK was up there, a little higher than the French. But then going down through a couple of other countries. So I think it was, imposing your will on others, and there's all kinds of ways it can be done, but the traditional way was by taking over territory and people.
I think one of the, can you hear me with that?
Yes, yeah. I feel like I'm talking into the...
But one of the things that I was thinking about when you asked the question and when I was listening to other people as it related to imperialism, as a psychologist, I think about the effects of things. And so one of the things that I think about when I think about how places were often colonized, and language is a very interesting kind of thing. And when people say language doesn't matter, I always say, I know that language has an impact on behavior. So for example, if I want to harm you, I would probably think of you other than human. I'd probably think of you as something less than human. So when we think about cockroaches, I don't know how many of you, I grew up in Louisiana with big flying cockroaches. I don't, you just be walking through your house, minding your own business. Company over, you're like, oh my God, the cockroaches. So most of us don't like cockroaches. So when I relabel people as a cockroach or a rat, how many of you? So when you think about that, languages can often be used as a form of dismembering people, okay? And so when you are dismembered, it's not just a physical kind of dismemberment, but it can be a dismemberment around replacing your past memories of who you were, inserting new memories. And that happened quite often when people would go in and colonize, that they would take away the memories of the people, including renaming areas, and then renaming the people. So it wasn't just renaming the people, but it was also things that were familiar to them. And as they would get further and further away from remembering who they were before, it was easier to control and to dispossess. And so when I think about imperialism, I think about those kinds of ways of disconnecting people in order for exploitation to take place and also to dispossess.
I wanted to reiterate, it's an open panel discussion. Yes, so if you want to raise your hand, Brittany has a mic over here. If you ever have a question, comment, concern, feel free to voice that.
Stay and safe. Especially oh, a here. Challenge, because I know you all are lost.
And here. Yeah. Oh, that's why I'm here. Sorry, we're going to make Brittany run around.
She's
going to
get a
statue. Yeah, you're going to get those 5,000 steps in
a girl. I really like your point about the language, and I think the Imperial Powers use that as a strategy, because if you look at Ivory Coast and Ghana, Ivory Coast was colonized by the French, and Ghana was colonized by the British, and so they speak English and French. So if someone from Ivory Coast wanted to go over to Ghana, you know, there's that language barrier. So I think they strategically planned that out. Like, we have so many, well, we're just limited. We're not united, and we have so many barriers breaking us, and I just think it was strategically planned that way. Which was smart on their end, because we can't retaliate.
To add background to that, in the Ivory Coast next to Ghana, my tribe is called the Akan tribe, and we actually extend through a good amount of Ghana just before you get there.
Thanks for the comment. Mm-hmm.
So, first, thanks to BALSA and everybody who helped put this together. This is awesome. Thanks to all the professors, faculty, and staff, and people that helped put this together. But my question is, in the African American community, sometimes I feel like people don't know where they come from, and they don't know their ancestors. And being a psychologist or teaching psychology, how do you think that affects them? So you don't know where you come from, how do you know where you're going?
And I think, you know, I was just talking about this in class last night, because we read an article, and most of the students in my class are not of African descent, but it was by a West African writer, and she talked about the importance of ancestry. And so, you know, I was asking a bunch of questions because I gave the kind of paraphrased a quote that sometimes the ancestors are speaking to us, and they speak to us until we get the message. But you have to be open to their messages. Now, that's not usually something you talk about in a classroom at a state school. but so this whole idea of how sometimes we have to create a narrative. So, for example, when I would do I'm a clinical psychologist by training, so people would come into me and they would say things like, because trauma, they couldn't remember things about their past. Because trauma interrupts the capacity to have the memories, because the way that trauma works is, if you've been traumatized, you can't even remember the good memories of that time, because it eventually will lead to the bad or the painful memories. So you see where I'm going with this? So I think that as a people, because of the trauma we have experienced, sometimes it's hard for us to allow those ancestors. And I'm not talking, you know, I said that it helps that I'm from Louisiana, because I have a broad way of thinking about life. So I don't think that people are psychotic when they tell me certain things. So that's why I guess I don't do therapy anymore. Because some things seem very plausible. Makes sense. I grew up around when people doing voodoo and things like that, so it's like, hey, you know. So that's why I guess I just teach now. But I think that the whole idea around trauma, and so part of what I do, and I'm doing with people in my family, particularly children, is saying, even if you create a narrative of who you think you are, that's legitimate, because who I think I am will have an impact on how I act. So if I think I was just watching something from Toni Morrison. Is this true? Yeah. I love Toni Morrison. Because Toni Morrison said, I always grew up knowing I was superior. She said, because I always take the moral high ground. Mm. So she's created a narrative that was handed to her from her father that allowed for that. So I think that that's the kind of thing we have to start to create narratives. And one of the times, I was in Kenya, and I was going to observe children related to rites of passage. And so it was this very interesting process that they would have, that every week the kids would get together and they had to talk about their ancestry. And so the kids were like, we want you to do it. And I remember sitting there like, I can't do it, because they could go way back.
And I couldn't even go but a few generations back. And so then I got really quiet and uncomfortable. And so finally this one person said, and I don't think that I'm a descendant of people from Kenya, but he basically told the children that, you remember the stories we would say about the ones who were stolen? She's one of the ones who was stolen, and we're very proud of who she is. So I created a narrative based on what a little child asked me. So these are two stories about children who taught me, and in my mind, those are the ancestors talking to me. I know that sounds crazy.
Say that again. No.
I know that sounds crazy.
To add on to that, do you think imperialism plays a role in African Americans not knowing who they are?
Yes.
Because yes. People are telling you who you are,
yes,
who you're going to come out to be. I've had an elementary school teacher say, you guys are going to end up statistics.
That's it.
And then you get that in your mind, and that's who you become. So.
That's a part of that colonized mind or enslaved mind. And I always tell people, because I know that I'm a product of this, I always say, why is it, this is a question I ask myself, other people's opinion of who I am is more important than my opinion of who I think I am. And I don't want to give up that much power to somebody else to define who I am. And so I do a lot of reading of like people like Audre Lorde, who said I had to find myself for myself. If not, I would have been crushed by people and eaten alive by people's perceptions. That's paraphrasing of who I am. And I do think that that's a big piece of what's happening, that we have to reculturate. That's a term by a person named Joel Spring. He talked about that the process of education was intended to deculturalize people in the United States, including people of wherever you are, Latino, Hispanic descent, because I think about Houston talking about Hispanic, you get it? Hispanic. People of African descent, people of Asian descent, and definitely American Indians. That if you read his book called The Deculturalization of America's Peoples or something like that, he talks about that it was a very clear process when you think about sending American Indian kids to boarding schools because they wanted to de-Indianize them, that's for lack of a better term. So you're right, I think it was a very clear picture. And that's why part of my training when I was a little kid was to my parents and other people gave me a different recording to play when people would say things like that. Because I had a so I have one thing of people saying, you know, you're gonna become a statistic. But I have another thing saying, and you're gonna become a statistic that people will be talking about. You know, so I have those two narratives, and I think that that's what we have to tell our children. And we can't rely on anyone else to educate our children. Because again, a quote by Malcolm X, you have to be a fool to allow your enemy to educate your children. Mm-hmm. And so I think that part of going through the traditional educational system, I always had a common narrative to some of the things that I was reading. And so when I was, even when I was in grad school, working on my PhD, and it was like eight of us in the class, and there were some things that get said in there, and I was like, this is unreal. I had a professor say, first we let them in the kitchen, now they're all over the house. I was like, whoa. I'm glad I grew up with a common narrative of who I was, because chances are I would have dropped out. But I sat there and I kind of laughed and I said, yep, and I'm going to own the house in my head. And then I called my father and he said, baby, you want me to come beat him up?
So my questions are for both panelists and they're framed a follow-up from Kia's question. So knowing that we have the African Americans and descendants of the African diaspora have to continue creating these counter-narratives so that we can be functional in this country because of the effects of imperialism, how does that, as law students, Professor Bach, how does that, how can we use, how do we use those, knowing those that is current status quo and having to community build with other people that are also effects that have effects of imperialism, like she mentioned, the Native Americans, the Latin Americans. What advice can you give to people that are benefiting from the imperialism white people, and also people of color that are continuously having to deconstruct these negative narratives and reconstruct these positive narratives to be functional. Because the way I've internalized this entire topic as a law student here in Vermont is, okay, I need to keep myself encouraged because people want to save me, even though I don't feel like I need to be saved. So people want to save me because imperialist people feel like people need to be saved, but I don't need to be saved. So that dynamic, socially and also in our professions, people that think people need to be saved, Professor Black, and people that tell me that I need to be saved, Dr. Morris.
That's a big question.
We didn't put that one in the email, we're sorry.
It's warm.
Yeah.
take it out a step from a law school, because when you, Donnie, were talking about names and pejorative terms, right? It struck me that what we have all been, all of us, have been living with since last Friday is someone taking the term immigrant and making it into a negative term. And part of what I am amazed to see is how many people, white and others, so old school oppressors, or at least oblivious maybe, realize that calling other people immigrants and not calling ourselves immigrants was just ludicrous. And so you had relatively spontaneous, I'm not on those pop-up things, right? Demonstrations at the airports, from the get-go, I mean, starting with Saturday morning. And you have, when you look at the photos of those, you see the broad fabric of what is the United States, which is we are all immigrants, unless you are still affiliated with your tribe and, you know, have, I don't know, what X degree parentage, right, lineage in your tribe. We're all immigrants here. So I think the key thing is understanding, one, where this country came from. And that's, as lawyers in law school, you get a big dose of that by learning about the Constitution and how it's been interpreted in a variety of ways over time. So let's be clear. So I think that learning the language of the law, but not losing your own language, your sense of identity, that's the trick. And trying to do that in first year, I think is a real challenge. Because first year is kind of refreshing. But I think keeping track of that, having the people that hold you up and see you as who you are, regardless of their color, because it won't always be exactly true, I think, the color, that's the trick. But fundamentally, we were all, faculty too, we were all one else. Right, so we've got that in common already, and we're all immigrants.
I think when you brought up the saving thing, I thought, I'd like to tell stories, I'm sorry. But one time, a friend of mine was swimming in the lake, and my dog became really nervous, and so she went out and, you know, and she was trying to save my friend and almost drowned her. So I always use that as a really weird way of explaining that sometimes there's a reason people are doing what they do, and they don't need anyone else to tell them what to do, because to me that's another form of colonization, where you come in and you say, I think you need to be saved. And then you do like my dog, RP, and go try to save people. There's a book that just came out called No More Heroes. I'm in the process of reading it right now. So this whole idea about how do we, when we don't need to be saved, to let someone know that they may be intending to be trying to help. But the virtue, the very virtue of not asking me what I need,
It would have been different if my friend would have been yelling, help me, RP, come save me. And this is the way you need to save me. That's qualitatively different than swimming out thinking that someone needs help when they really don't need it. Because in some ways, that still puts you in a superior stance by feeling like you are going to help, that you are going to save people from themselves or from a life that you don't even understand. So I think it's really important for us as allies to ask, how might it be helpful, rather than assuming we already know, because again, that's supremacy in another way.
Anyone
else? Oh, wait. Well, let me give you guys a two cents of, you know, my idea of imperialism. So I'm going to read a definition from Webster. It says, a policy or practice by which a country or group increases its power by gaining control of over other countries of the world, and generally poor countries. So, you know, when you talk about language, so I'm from Cape Verde, we speak Portuguese, and so imperialism to me is Portugal maintaining their status in Cape Verde even after our independence. So Portuguese is our official language, so Portugal provides the books. So every book that, you know, we study from kindergarten up to now, up to high school, to the highest level in school is provided by Portugal. So they have always incentivized, let's have a follow-up, which is basically countries that speak Portuguese, and every year let's unite it, but Portugal still keeping control. So if people need Medicare or any type of insurance, Portugal provides. So Portugal is still present, and Portugal is still sending the products they need. So, you know, Cape Verde is still a resource of Portugal. Another thing, so we're thinking about countries, but also groups, you know, taking over the smaller countries. For instance, Cape Verde has a lot of partnerships with the European Union, and so big commercial ships go to Cape Verde and do a large catch of, you know, fishes. So your everyday fisherman, you know, I have difficulties now and with all the licenses, so, you know, that has played a role. So, globalization, so let's import food, let's not make it. So it's displacing the farmers, you know. You don't have the capacity to compete against all these major groups or countries that, you know, go to your country. When we got independence from Portugal, one of the freedom fighters, his name is Amilcar Cabral, said, you know, it's not because this thing is from Portugal or is from foreign that we'll reject it. He said also, it's not because it's from foreign that we'll accept it. Mm-hmm. So we have to make a balance. You know, he said, oh, we don't have materials to do our own cultivation. They have these materials. We won't do it by hand. We use their products. So we just have to make a real assessment. What is to use, what is not to use. I guess, you know, when you ask about, you know, being helped, we have to understand that not everyone, so even the whites, you know, they are also a product of imperialism, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, what is the son or the daughter of, you know, if your father was part of the big group, what are you to do, you know? You know, you are a product of it. And you may want to help people, you know, just have to understand, you know, accept what you can and reject what you can't.
Yeah. And just take to follow through with that, it was just, I guess what I was trying to get through that, I think Professor Bach and Dr. Morris did a great job in furthering my point, is the fact that sometimes we approach communities not knowing that our approach might be internalized as imperialism. But when we approach them saying, oh, I'm going to save you, oh, I'm going to save you by implementing Christianity in your colony. I'm going to save you by teaching you how to farm correctly and use certain tools right. I'm going to save you because I think I can do this better for you. I think the Lord isn't property for the one else right now, right? So it's, and I think you might be right. The way you're doing it is right way. The way you are helping me is helping me. But I might be hesitant because the effect of imperialism, You know what I mean? When I've been internalized all these hundreds of years, thousands of years, and I think as attorneys, we don't see it that way sometimes. I think we feel like they were so far removed, and I think you know, lucky for coming up with this topic, because I think it touches on so many different aspects in our communities and also in our profession.
Thank you guys so much, everyone, for planning this beautiful evening. And I would be really curious to hear your guys' personal thoughts and reactions to the concept of white privilege and how that relates to the idea of a narrative, a positive narrative, a harmful narrative, and how I personally get really confused about that and what the proper way to deal with that is. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
That's a hard question. I'm at a loss for words. You know how one word starts off with one particular meaning and in a real clear context, and then over time it transforms and becomes kind of this weirdly co-opted word and then a phrase, and you have no idea what it means anymore. And I think it starts off because originally you haven't really thought through the implications of it. So that's a long answer to say that's what I think has happened with the term white privilege. In the same way, political correct had a different meaning when it first came out and people were talking about that, and then all of a sudden it was twisted and now it's such a negative term. And I think that for me, a lot of the original thoughts around white privilege was to, and male privilege and you know, heterosexual privilege, and the list goes on, of any dominant group privilege, was to show that the way that the world was shaped and created was to give you an advantage if you represented the dominant group. And what we didn't really realize is that it's more complex than just one of those factors. So when you think about whiteness, it's a lot more complicated than just race. So I always tell people, even if you're in a room full of just white people, white privilege is still present, you know? And I've internalized things around whiteness and what's superior. So I think that it's a complicated term, and I know that one of the first conversations I had with a colleague of mine who is an African-American woman said she said, absolutely hate the term. She said, because now the way that some white people are using it is once again to engage in some of this perceptions that people are less than. So it's like, well, you see, I have white privilege. And so therefore, again, that kind of rescue mentality sets in. And for her, it's hard to, you know, how many of you like to feel like victims? And so she feels like the whole way that white privilege is used now is so far from removed from its original intent that now it feels like it's to cause people with less privilege to feel even worse than they felt before. And then for white people to use it as, I don't have any privilege. Well, yeah, because as a woman, you know, so it all gets all mixed up. So if you want to hear a good talk, if you're free next Tuesday at 6 o'clock, come to King's Day. Ran Kusin will be there, and she will explain it to you. Because she's very good at explaining it.
So I'm getting a kick out of this, because I would never call myself an originalist, you know, in the law, right? Especially at this time. But so I don't think I have as complex a definition for white privilege, because I still think of it as what I guess you're just finding is the original, which is where white people in predominantly white societies realized the inherent privilege of their skin color. And I not thought it more deeply than that. My opening anecdotal story about my kids, right, realizing that they were the minority, the outlier. And yet, in that culture, we had privilege because of Europeans, that ironically, that had gone before us and had given us that privilege. But the simple identification of the privilege seems so very, very basic to me. I appreciate that it's gotten more complicated, but
So I grew up in the 60s and the 70s. I was born in 62. And that was a time, so getting back to male privilege, that you would actually see ads in the paper that said, for males only, for females only. It was actually legit to put that in employment ads. And of course, this was post the 60s and the Civil Rights Act. I'm making this point because I think that the sense of privilege is understanding your place in a the presence that you have. And it's a greater awareness. And I just don't think, I think there are so many people, I guess the bottom line is there are whites now who don't understand it. And you can show as many documentaries as you want of where somebody's two CVs go in or two people reply to an ad in the paper. And then you videotape the whole experience where the non-white person is treated differently. And they still either don't understand it or don't want to own it. So I apologize. I don't have a more uplifting shake on that, except that I'd like to think that we're past, not post-racial, of course, but, you know, that we understand the privilege that we have. Just like I understand the privilege of having been the first person in my family to go to college. I got a lot of privilege out of that as well. But the racial piece is fundamental to the U.S.
So this is my last question that I want you guys to answer. And the question is, I talked a lot in the video about struggling with my identity, and I wanted to know what role do you think imperialism has played in how descendants of the African diaspora identify themselves racially, ethnically, etc. What role do you think imperialism plays in that? Because we also had in the video where someone said, where Amira said, you know, one of the negative effects of imperialism is that people from the diaspora don't identify as African. And I just struggled with identity with being mixed. So where do you think imperialism fits in that? I was trying to give you time to answer.
I'll jump in.
Go ahead.
I'll give you time.
The law professor helped me here.
No, I think that you all answered this already in the video. I mean, you studied it for us and gave us the notes. So a piece of it is that it's by the colonizing or the imperial country that has usually made the country that they've gone into or the society they've gone into as lesser. They perceive it, right? They're cultivating or civilizing at the same time, really. Extracting natural resources and wealth for themselves. And so that systemically is going to otherize and often usually debase, right, the imperialized culture. And so as people in that imperialized culture move to a new place, I think it would be pretty normal to take that perception that others have imposed on you there.
Yeah, and then it goes back to what I was saying about being deculturalized and the need to be reculturalized, because you buy the narrative that of superiority, and then you not only buy into it, but you do what Alan Johnson calls conferred, where I can't remember the term that he uses, but where you actually give the power to people that you see as superior to you, because you buy into the narrative that they are superior.
It's referring to like the oppressor, so to speak, or right. The former oppressor, because of that history of always right. Receiving their instruction.
Right.
I
thank you for helping me. No, help me some more. No, I'm asking for help. This is how you can help me.
Well, it's kind of been on my mind since the start of this, just the whole, like, the Willie Lynch book or whatever that was written on how to control a slave. The fact that is a huge part of our American history, and that a lot of us don't know anything about that. A lot of us don't know anything about Willie Lynch and how that,
right.
You know, was used to actually oppress people, and it was a system that was applied and it actually worked. And because of that, we have generation upon generation of abused parents, essentially, abused ancestors, and so it's sort of in our, well, in some people's genetics, more or less, to kind of defer in that sense, and like, we can't really ignore the fact that that pain travels to the blood. I'm not a scientist, I'm not a biologist or anything like that, but I do sincerely believe that when you feel things physically, they affect your blood and affect your brain and affects the genes that they pass on.
And I think that, you know, you're right about this whole idea around, that's why I brought up the idea of trauma. And a lot of people now are looking at the impacts of intergenerational trauma. There's certain things that if you, you know, even if your great-grandparents experienced a trauma, how was that trauma transmitted to you? So that's some of the things that they're talking about. So there's a psychologist who has a whole process of how she works with people related to this trauma. And I haven't read any data on how effective it's been, but when I read the chapter of the book of her describing it, in my mind, in theory, it could work by the way that she works with people using this kind of trauma model. So I think you're right. And I know that I've had, because some of my American Indian friends will talk about when they're in certain places that they have kind of a bodily memory of things like the, excuse me, like bodily memories of the Trail of Tears, for example. Yeah, I know that one time, I'm not claustrophobic, but I remember one time I had to go into one of those machines where you go, you know, what is that called? MRI. And I remember going in and you're on your back and you're going in and there's plenty of room. And I remember I started to have like a real panic attack, not like a pretend panic. I was really feeling like I was about to die. So I kept pushing a little button and it looked like the young woman was like in slow motion coming. I'm like, can you get here so I can get out of this thing? Girl, and so she let me out, and I can remember thinking, wow, is this a middle passage memory? Because I've never been that afraid. I can go into small areas, but it was something about the way that I had to, and you had to, you know, and I remember it wasn't just a feeling like, oh my God, this is, I was really freaking out in there. And so then they gave me some Ambien and I was okay. And I think that, I say that kind of tongue in cheek, but I think that sometimes that's why we dull our feelings, because they become so overwhelming. And we dull it with a whole host of things, including, you know, watching television endlessly. And like, we engage in a whole bunch of weapons of mass destruction.
Any questions?
All right. Comments. We need comments.
Comments?
I was going to ask a question, but I tried to make a comment too. I find it really compelling that the way this conversation has been framed in terms of looking at the personal and emotional, aspects. I forgot this is being filmed. Personal and emotional aspect of imperialism and being oppressed. And I'm going to steal a page from Prudence's book a little bit. I saw something on her Facebook that was really compelling, that was talking about how to look at racism as a form of mental illness, and that people, white people, who act in racist ways, that you can look at that as a form of mental illness, and that I've seen that trauma, what you're talking about with trauma, that this trauma is imperialism is this trauma that we all experience on some level. So, you know, I guess because of my own particular racial identity, but also because of the moment we're living in, I couldn't help but think, well, so here we are in this space where we're thinking about this on this level, and that's really good, but is there a way to approach folks who are very, in an emotional, guttural way, reacting against a lot of this and saying, no, I'm the oppressed one. No, I'm the one who's getting a set, you know, bad lot in life, and actually we need to flip things the way things used to be more. And that, you know, it's not exactly necessarily a unique point in our history. I mean, we've had a lot of backlashes before, but how do, I guess, So that's my comment part of it. My question is, just, you know, I opened this to the floor, like, are there ideas on how to, because part of this is political in terms of, you know, the machinations, but part of it too is this emotion that people are feeling, and I see it a lot, even in school here, that this sort of feeling of I don't know, sort of trying to, instead of moving out of this trauma, trying to stay in this trauma and say, well, you know, this is what's been familiar and what's been working in the past, so let's, you know, stick to it or do more of it. Does that question make sense? I can try to rephrase it.
I just have to say, one thing is the American Psychological and Psychiatric Association wanted to, there was a major debate about if racism should be part of the DSM. And it was supposed to be under a delusional disorder. And part of it, it was a long list of things, if you've ever looked at the DSM, that the person would have to meet in order to get it as a true diagnosis. And but it received so much debate that, you know, there's a DSM-6 coming out pretty soon, I'm sure, and I think that it'll be re-debated. But then also I saw a Law and Order episode. It was very good. The person was claiming racism because of a murder that he had committed. And his lawyer was ordered, his black lawyer was ordered arguing on his behalf. And it was a true disorder. So they had this fictitious psychiatrist who testified. So never mind. You probably never watched that because it's not good. Anyway, I'm sorry, I just wanted to say that that's true, and they're trying to, people are trying to debate if that should be a part of the DSM.
A quick follow-up is that, I guess, the question is, whether racism is considered a mental illness or not, how do we in ourselves, and also with our peers, try to talk it through, and then also, because I guess to share my own personal story, my father's Mexican and my mom's Anglo, and in my own family, I mean, I never felt, in my white side of the family, I never felt unaccepted, but at the same time, there's this like weird cognitive dissonance where they'll be very accepting of me and like don't, you know, ask any questions of, well, why, you know, but like then say things like, oh yeah, you know, immigrants, yeah, and so it's like, wait, what? wait, what do you think I am? So, like, I guess trying to think of strategies on, I don't know, maybe it's not our responsibility, but like how to constructively talk to people if that's something we choose to do.
So, like, we have some answers.
Man, I would say that once there's a certain age that you're not going to change people, and so I would say, like, we need to focus on those around our age, you know, that we can reason with and stuff like that. Obviously, yeah, the children, you know.
I said little kids.
Yeah, we have to focus on the little ones, you know, so that they're not corrupted by the older adults that they have no choice but to deal with, who actually do love them but can't get over their own cognitive dissonance, whatever you want to call it. I will say this, I fundamentally disagree that racism can be framed as a mental illness or anything like that. No, it's a choice. It's a complete and utter choice to decide to hate or continue to hate somebody based on their race, to continue to reaffirm things that you know aren't true because you can look and find an example that counters whatever generalization you tend to make. So you have to be careful with labeling things in such a way that, oh, this person has no control over the way they feel. You see what I'm saying? Like, it's okay to do that with certain things, you know, like, I will go and say, if we were going to go and say racism could be a mental illness, we might as well be going backward to APA to where they were calling homosexuals mentally ill or mentally disabled. No, it's we can't be so quick to, you know, kind of excuse people like that.
She had a question.
Hi, everyone. We have time for one more question or comment. And I will encourage everyone to continue the conversation, because this is very important. Thank you.
I guess it's just a comment that I feel like it would be a disservice to my own country if I didn't talk about it. I'm from the Philippines, a country that's well known to have passed from one colonizer to another. So in effect, imperialism has been part of my blood, has been part of my people. We were colonized even before we had a national identity, and now we are struggling with, my country is struggling with forming that identity in the face of all of these imperialist values that have been inculcated in our cultures. I think what I learned most about growing up in a country that learned to revere white culture, you know, when you see white people in movies, you see white people talking, you see white people in the news, the effect always has been that that's not us. We can't do that. You know, we can't be democratic like that. We can't be powerful like that because we are not white. And this is in a country that's like, we haven't been under American rule for 60 years. So in effect, we've had our own culture for quite some time, very young. But the effect of imperialism, it doesn't end when the country leaves.
Right.
I mean, there are so many things that we have to deal with. And I think the challenge for people from my country is that it's always very attractive to go out and go into these countries like the US, study here, and then live here, because it's always the greener pasture. It's very glamorous, it's very Hollywood, you know? So much money, oh my God, it's fabulous. But I think the challenge is always to encourage people to go back, because there is definitely knowledge in places like the US. There's so much to learn. But you have to go back and bring that knowledge back to your community so that you uplift your people in that community as well. So, yeah.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for the questions, comments, concerns, discussions. Please come to more of our events if you want to hear more of the discussions and to continue it. We want to give a few thank yous. First to Dr. Morris, thank you so much for coming out today. We appreciate your hard work. Our videographer, Michael. Of course, Professor Brennan.